70 years ago, when I started a PhD program in the academic study of Islam, my area of focus, where I read the aphorisms of Ibn Attallah and was dazzled by the divine love shared between Rumi and his teacher Shams. The discourses of the Sufis appealed to my heart, and I gradually find myself regularly in the company of the lovers, also enamored of the Sufi path. My fondness for the Sufis persisted as I set out to do my doctoral research, though it had very little to do with the soul. My research focused on the two largest and most prominent ethnic Muslim groups in the United States, African Americans and South Asians, also known as Desis or Indo-Pacs. My thesis was essentially this: the race and class divides that separate blacks, whites, and various immigrant groups also extend into the American Ummah, creating boundaries between different ethnic Muslims. Muslims immigrating to the United States find themselves in a unique situation in which, like most immigrants to the United States, they are conditioned to hold black Americans with contempt, thus distancing themselves from black people, their neighborhoods, and their schools. At the same time, however, Muslim immigrants find that black Americans make up a considerable part of their ummah in America. The concept of ummah, of Islamic brotherhood and sisterhood, I argue, brings African American and immigrant Muslims together, even if just temporarily or in certain moments, making the American ummah one of the most promising sites of black and immigrant unity in the country. Indeed, the Islamic concept of unity moves some Muslim immigrants, though certainly not all, to fight the tendency to see and treat blacks as though they are inferior. So in the process of my research, I regularly visited spaces like the one that we are in tonight, a space where our common love for Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, and his beloved messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, brings black American and immigrant Muslims together. The difference was that for my research, the immigrants in these ummah spaces were not African, but Indian and Pakistani. In these black and Indo-Pak ummah spaces, the sheikhs were white, Arab, black, and Indian, and they attracted all of us, black, brown, and white, and united our hearts. I published my first book from this research in 2008 with the title American Muslim Women, Negotiating Race, Class, and Gender Within the Ummah. The last pages of my book encourage American Muslims to act with ihsan, or beauty, if we truly hope to improve race relations in the American Ummah. Non-black Muslims, for example, must humble themselves and change their behavior if they have been told that they have offended a black person. And black Muslims, when they have been wronged, must forgive, make excuses for, and look for the good in the one who has acted in an offensive manner. To apply ihsan, I wrote, does not mean that we ignore an injustice and allow it to go unchecked. Rather, it means creating beautiful relations between people built on mercy and trust, so that as we confront sensitive issues of power and privilege in our communities, we are more likely to listen to one another, care about our future together, and work with one another for change. Unity, love, and ihsan are inextricably linked. True unity cannot happen without ihsan, indicated by love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his beloved messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, above all else. In turn, Allah is the one who grants love between hearts. We learn this from the earliest Muslim community. The people of Yathrib were desperately seeking unity, a stop to a vicious, long-lived civil war, when they pledged themselves to Allah and his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They devoted themselves to Allah and the messenger with an excellent devotion, for they were immediately ready to protect the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even if it cost them their lives. From that point on, they carried out acts distinguishing them as people of Islam. For their devotion, Allah Ta'ala rewarded them with love, For certainly the Quran states about this love, He it is who supports you with His help and with the believers and join their hearts. If you had spent all this or all that is on the earth, it would not have joined their hearts, but God joined them together. The topic of Muslim unity and love was also a personal interest for me during the time of my research. However, Allah Ta'ala would make it deeply personal in a way that only He can orchestrate. Certainly, He is Al-Latif, the kind, the subtle. In 2012, Taiba Taylor, rahimahullah, asked me to write an article on Ihsan for Aziza magazine. It was a huge honor to strive to impart the meaning of Ihsan and to describe the muhsineen, or the beauty makers. In the article, I refer to the hadith of Jibril, in which Ihsan is described as worshiping Allah as if you see Him, if not, He sees you. I wrote that when we are in a constant state of awareness that Allah sees us, we make every deed beautiful. And I cited the famous hadith Qudsi that describes the type of person or friend of Allah who has reached this sought-after state in which her acts of worship become so beautiful, surpassing the minimum required of her, that Allah loves her. And when Allah Ta'ala loves her, He grants her the ability to act as though she sees Him, manifested in the fact that her every action brings about that which Allah Ta'ala loves and desires. I ended my article noting that in the Islamic tradition, such friends of Allah have been described as the people of tasawwuf, or Sufism. After completing the article, I realized that some might think I am among these people just because I can write about them. And so I made a dua. O Allah, make me among the muhsineen. This was a turning point for me, though I didn't realize it at the time. As Sheikh Mahdi once noted, the ulama of tasawwuf say that tasawwuf is the knowledge of taste. You have to taste it, test it, and experience it. Up until this point, I hadn't really tasted it. I had studied and written about it. In December 2012, 4 months after I made the dua to be among the muhsineen, my beloved husband expressed to me his interest in pursuing a second marriage with a dear sister in our masjid community. Before I utter another word, let me reassure you. At that time, we had been married for 8 years, and throughout those 8 years, I had always told my husband that I was open to his marrying a second wife. By Allah's mercy, polygyny has not been an oppression for me. My husband neither took a wife secretly nor put me in a financial hardship. My husband loves and fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and loves me dearly. May Allah strengthen, preserve him, and increase him in taqwa and wealth. That said, polygyny is a hardship and a test, and I knew that it would be from the outset. But I embraced it the moment that it truly became real for me, because I immediately saw it as the path to Ihsan, my personal path to beauty and Allah's love. Let me explain. Long before polygyny, I had always wanted to be among those described in this divine hadith. My love belongs by right to those who love another for me, who sit together for me, who visit one another for me, and who give generously for me. I saw polygyny as a clear-cut opportunity to love someone purely for the sake of Allah, and as a result, receive the love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises. How so? Because it is exceptionally rare for a woman to naturally love the person her husband has chosen to marry, especially in a society that teaches us to hate the other woman. So to love her, it would have to be for Allah. From the divine hadith that I cherished, I knew the steps to loving my husband's wife. Make the intention to love her, sit with her, visit her, and to abundantly bestow gifts upon her. Of course, this is easier said than done. When I set out to practice these steps, it was painful at moments, and naturally so, for it required a sort of dying of myself. Indeed, it is not easy to come face to face with the person with whom your spouse shares a substantial amount of affection, time, and wealth. It is not easy to sit with your husband's wife, especially in the mosque, when you care what others are thinking. Indeed, it is impossible to do it without dying of oneself. Now, I could begin to taste the Sufi concept to die before dying. The path to Allah involves discomfort, even pain, because for hearts to be purely for Allah, they must be released of their attachment to that which is other than Allah, ta'ala. And so when it sometimes hurts to be in the company of my husband's wife, or to see her carrying their son, it is because one by one, Allah is removing my attachment to all the things that make me feel as though I am beautiful, excellent, and superior in the eyes of my husband or in the eyes of the world. My attachment to my physical features, to my knowledge and talents, to my credentials, to my marital status, to my wealth, to my friends, even to my spirituality. The only way to withstand this pain was to fill my heart with Allah, which meant attempting to not see her so much, but to see Allah. As Sheikh Hassan said, if you observe Allah in everything, you will end up by seeing Allah in everything. This high station of seeing Allah in everything, of course, I had not achieved, or have not achieved. But I believe polygyny nudges the seeker to aspire for this state. Because what happens is that you begin to be concerned about what your spouse is giving someone else. And this causes negative emotions. And the only way to liberate yourself of these emotions is to say that I get what I get from Allah, not my husband. Likewise, when my sister wife receives, I aim to see Allah as the one giving. As unique individuals, sister wives are given different gifts from God and also from their husband. Even while fulfilling the Quranic condition to treat wives justly, a husband must give to his wives based on their hopes and needs, which will sometimes be different. Because the gifts are different, like when one wife is carrying a child and the other isn't, jealous feelings can easily arise. What further helps me overcome these feelings is my desire to be like the Ansar, whom Allah praises for his exceptional love and brotherhood. It is mentioned that they harbored no desire in their hearts for what had been given to the immigrants, and they preferred them over themselves, even though they too were poor. After making the intention to make love and preference my path, I happened to be listening to a lecture on Ihsan, where the speaker stated, "The secret to love is preference." SubhanAllah, his words confirm what I saw unfolding in my life. That is incredible, abundant love. This love appeared in the very beginning of polygyny and always overshadowed the moments of pain. Interestingly, it was not the hardship of polygyny that led me to the tariqa, but it was love. For sure, it is because of the legacy of Sheikh Hassan, radiallahu anhu, that I'm here with you today. Because when I realized that it was truly time for me to tread the path of tasawwuf, I didn't have to look far. The women whom I turned to included women who took the tariqa from Sheikh Hassan and whom I knew from my work in Muhammad Community Masjid. Indeed, when I finally took the tariqa, the first question I asked Sheikh Mahi had to do with love for the sake of Allah. Love is received and it is given. I was especially captivated by and curious about love in its giving form, as a pouring forth from the heart, a pouring forth so profound that it takes you to Allah. Now, as I look back, it makes sense that I would seek a sheikh to bring the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to life for me at a time when I was experiencing exceptional love toward Allah's creation. Because, after all, Rasulullah is the master of loving creation. His love and the expression of his love are so wide because He loved without expecting anything in return. He loved purely for Allah. We too are capable of loving in this manner, but it can only happen if we are truly content and satisfied with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when you are content with Allah and His Messenger, you have everything. When you have Allah, you want for your sister with an exceptional comfort because you realize that your wishes and hopes for her do not diminish what you have with Allah. As I conclude, my prayer is that the lessons that I am learning from this special love experience on the path to Allah will assist me in loving my husband's wife for the sake of Allah. My prayer is that Allah Ta'ala expands my heart to love as generously as Rasulullah, and to pour out that love to the person that the world would least expect me to love, but whom Allah would be pleased for me to love. I end with a clarification. My message today is not a call to polygyny. Rather, I call us to bear witness to the fact that, as Sheikh Hassan and Sheikh Mahi have reminded us on many occasions, Islam calls us to brotherhood and sisterhood. As I demonstrate in my book on the American Ummah, the Ummah is filled with spaces and opportunities for people from different ethnic, cultural, economic backgrounds to come together when they would not otherwise. Similarly, for each of us personally, our faith pushes us to love in ways we would not otherwise. And when it comes to love for our brother or sister, the people of Ihsan love with an exceptional love. O Allah, make us the people of Ihsan. Make us the people who fulfill the prophetic command that states, forgive him who wrongs you, join him who cuts you off, do good to him who does evil to you, and speak the truth, although it be against yourself. And make us the better of the two people Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam describes in this statement. No two people love one another, but the better of them is the one whose love for his brother or sister is greater. And O Allah, forgive my error or offense, any error or offense I may have made tonight, correct it and guide us on the straight path. Amen. 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 Amen.